Offsite Dirt. This is Karen Benner with and Building Better with Karen, and I'm excited to be here today with Robby Schwarz. Robby and I connected during a stint where I was living out in Denver, Colorado. We had an opportunity to work together, and I am a big fan of all things that Robby is about. He is an advocate for our industry, works very hard on helping to develop our building codes, our energy codes, definitely something that's important to the work that we do, and not something that a lot of us are necessarily have the stomach for, and Robby does. And I'm so grateful that people like Robby exist out there. And so I asked him to be a guest with me today on Building Better because, in addition to his background in home performance, which I'll let him share a little bit about here, I really wanted to bring him on to talk about the work that he's doing to help with the rebuilding efforts in Colorado from the Marshall Fire, which occurred in December of 2021 and was quite a devastating experience in a pretty highly populated residential area right outside of Denver, in between Denver and Boulder. And Robby was hired as the Marshall Fire New Homes Building Advisor. And what that means is that he has been advising on services which are at no cost to homeowners, builders, code officials, trade partners, and others involved in the rebuilding effort in order to facilitate rebuilding these homes that are comfortable, healthy, efficient, and will maximize cost savings. So this sounds like somebody had a great idea, maybe multiple people had a great idea to take advantage of what was a terrible situation and look for an opportunity to turn that into building better homes. So I wanted to talk about that today with Robby. So Robby, welcome to Offsite Dirt.
Yeah, thank you so much for having me. I appreciate it.
Yeah. So before we dig into some of the details related to your role with the Marshall Fire Rebuild, what else would you like to let our audience know about you and how you deserved to hold this position of facilitating the rebuilding efforts?
Yeah, I guess things aligned pretty well. They were looking for somebody who had experience in all of the different programs that are being incentivized through Xcel energy rebates and through the state of Colorado electrification rebates. And it happened that I had code experience. I had experience working with the Energy Star for New Homes program, the DOE Zero Energy Ready Homes program, and also Passive House as well. So those are the primary programs that are being incentivized there. And then I've been learning more and more about electrification and whatnot. And part of the work that I do, I'm part of a team that the Colorado Energy Office and also Xcel Energy have put together kind of separately, but we work to get together as a team to do education around codes. And so I've been asked to do some education about heat pumps and other aspects of electrification. So kind of all of that background just fit the need, I guess, that Boulder County had through their Energy Smart program, looking for somebody who could step in and answer questions from a broad group of individuals that were kind of entering into exploring these rebates in you know, from different levels of experience there. So my background has kind of met the need.
Yeah, which is amazing. It does sound like you checked all the boxes. Can you tell us if the Energy Smart program was something that was already in place at Boulder County, or was that something that also came out of this rebuilding effort?
No, the Energy Smart program has been a program that Boulder County has been running for quite some time. It's primarily, my understanding is that it's primarily been focused on existing homes. And they worked with Clear Result, and before Clear Result, a local energy rating company that's no longer in existence, to create an auditing program for Boulder. I think primarily the city of Boulder, and then it expanded into the county. Energy Smart is a county organization versus the city organization, which I think is important to understand, because the Marshall Fire took place in three jurisdictions, and Colorado's what we call a home rule state. So the three jurisdictions have their own codes and kind of their own programs. But so there's unincorporated Boulder County is what got hit by the fire. And then the towns of Superior and Louisville are within unincorporated Boulder County there. So the city of Boulder itself was not affected by the fire itself.
Wow. So it sounds like, as I said earlier, there was really an incentive across multiple jurisdictions, multiple stakeholders, you know, county, city officials, utility companies that were able to come together, work together to create this cohesive package opportunity to, as I said, take a terrible situation and at least spin it into something better for everybody, which yes. We love to hear that. We love to hear when people are able to come together and work together and look for opportunities to collaborate and improve our business.
Yeah, for sure. Xcel Energy, you know, kudos to them. Just incredible rebates that they're offering based off of these programs, or kind of a programmatic building process. The Boulder County also saw a need to try to promote rebuilding better, ultimately. And they put together a great website called rebuildingbetter.org, and lots of sustainable information there, but also information about how to build a construction team and kind of work through the process of rebuilding your house after, you know, a devastating event that happened there. And, you know, with the whole insurance industry side of the fire, and jurisdictions like Louisville and Superior, who had just adopted the 2021 IECC, and Louisville in particular adopted an appendix out of the IECC that was basically requesting of new homes that they build to zero energy to that level of construction there. The Home Builders Association, I believe this is just my opinion, created a bit of hysteria that the incremental cost to build from the 2018 to the 2021 codes would be up in the $100,000 range there. And wow. So everybody's so severely underinsured that created this kind of hysteria in the rebuilding arena there. So that I think that's part of why the rebates were developed, to help incentivize people to build back better again. Also what it ended up doing was the jurisdictions decided to relax the codes, to say basically you could rebuild to in Louisville and Superior, you could rebuild back to the 2018 codes, you could rebuild to the 2021 IECC slightly amended, or you could rebuild to their newly adopted zero energy 2021 code. And then unincorporated Boulder County basically just has kept their version of the 2021 codes. I think that was a mistake, because the insurance companies are supposed to pay you the incremental difference of the code that your house built was built to, and take that same footprint in essence to the modern day code, whatever it is. So the hysteria lowered that threshold. And then ultimately the insurance commission came in and said, you have to pay that incremental distance to the 2021 codes. And that's, you know, some insurance companies are honoring that, some aren't. It's kind of all over the boat there. But it's really been kind of ridiculous to me that insurance companies are asking people to itemize the cost of construction down to incredible detail, like what's the difference of the cost of building or installing an electrical outlet in 1990 versus to the 2021 codes. Wow. There. And it's significant money that is at stake here, but they're asking homeowners to do this exercise. And there are very few companies or consultants or others that are kind of in this world. You know, unfortunately, with the fires that are happening in California and whatnot, there might be an industry that comes up with consultants that help homeowners come up with this number, but the insurance company is not helping them.
Yeah, that sounds quite overwhelming. And you have, gosh, everything you just said touched on a lot of places we could go with this conversation. The weight that our own home building association can have sometimes in the conversation and public perception of what's going on, or even not necessarily public, but our public officials' perception as well. And then, and you brought up the insurance when it was just on the tip of my tongue to ask you, you know, how the insurance companies have factored into this whole equation. And you've already made that very clear that it is a big part of the conversation, which makes sense. And then something else you said that really surprised me, I want to make sure I heard correctly, that the part of the focus and the challenge with the insurance companies is looking at how the home had been originally built compared to current codes. So that could mean, as like you said, for example, installing an electrical outlet in 1990, but I would imagine that the people that were affected by this fire had homes that were drastically different in age, and the challenge, you know, of evaluating old to new is probably dozens and dozens of scenarios.
Yeah, there are definitely dozens of scenarios. The bulk of the homes were in that 1990, late 80s, 90s, okay. Houses there. Okay. So, but again, insurance companies aren't sharing that information, and I'm not sure that homeowners understand how to share that information. There are some spreadsheets that have been created that are starting to be shared there, but it's just a daunting process. And, you know, not to make it personal, but one of my parents passed away, and you go, you know, you're grieving and you have to do all this stuff with probate and all that stuff in the same kind of way with regards to going through this huge life-changing event of a fire. You're being asked to do this minutia of detail in order to rebuild your home, because, you know, there are other things that have created this great underinsurance issue that people have after a fire, but they're trying to reclaim as much money as they can. And the industry, to some extent, it seems like the industry is putting obstacles in their way. To some extent, you know, the industry is kind of all over the board as well. There's great success stories where people are, you know, have plenty of money to rebuild, and there are other people that just don't have anything to rebuild with. Almost, it's crazy. The disparity there is just crazy.
I can imagine. I can imagine it is. Yeah. So, so maybe we can, you know, dig into that a little bit further, and let's. let's hear from you a little bit more detail about what services you have been providing the most. I mean, that original blurb that I read to start off with said that, you know, there would be advising services for homeowners, builders, code officials, trade partners, and others. What have you found to be the bulk of what you're providing support for in this effort, and to whom and how?
Yeah, I've been finding it really interesting that how involved the homeowners are in their rebuild. The bulk of my experience in the home building industry has been working with production home builders. And in that world, you see a homeowner come into a sales office. They find the structure that they want to build, the house that they want to build, and they pick a lot and they build it, and they come out and see the construction a couple times, probably during the construction site.
Yeah.
Construction cycle there. In the custom world, you see people involved in the construction, in a little bit more depth. But in this case, people are not quite the GC, but they are in the mix there, in a lot of sense, micromanaging the process. And a lot of it is because they're so underinsured that they need to understand the cost of construction and the anything that they can do to make it the most cost-effective process that they can, and to receive any subsidies or rebates or anything that they can receive. Sure. So the rebate world that I am kind of working in are based off of these building programs. So if somebody builds back just to the 2021 IECC, they get $7,500 to do that. If they build to the Energy Star New Homes Program version 3.2, which hasn't actually been released throughout the country yet, they get $10,000. If they build to the DOE Zero Energy Ready Home Program, $12,500. I keep going here. There's the Energy Star version 3.2 plus Next Gen, which is Energy Star's new electrification incentive, their program. So you're doing the base Energy Star features on the home, adding electrification to that. Okay. That's a $17,500 rebate for that.
Wow.
Which also makes you eligible for the state of Colorado $10,000 rebate. And so we're seeing most folks that I'm talking with being interested in that, because the total incentive or rebate there is $27,500.
Wow.
There's also a rebate above that even to go to the passive house levels. And it doesn't matter if you do the FIAS version or the PHI version of passive house. It's a $37,500 rebate, and you're most likely you'll be eligible for the Colorado electrification rebate as well. So, you know, that's a hefty $47,000 there. So people are really interested in doing that. They don't understand that you just sign up for it, build your house, and claim it at the end. They don't kind of understand the process of building to a code or a program as you build your house. So a lot of what I do is explain the rebates and then explain the kind of the process of getting an energy rater involved, the verification, the certification of it, ensuring that they've pre-qualified with a energy rating index score, and that their builder has ultimately bought into the process and has kind of incorporated these specs and requirements that are built in these checklists into their construction process. And most of the rebuilding, well, I wouldn't say most of the rebuilding, but a lot of the builders are custom builders.
Okay.
That are rebuilding the homes there. And the majority of custom builders have never built to a program or taken part in
a
program before. So they don't know what they don't know. they say, yeah, I can build an energy efficient house, but they don't understand the process as well. So I've really been talking to I would say the majority of the homeowners, but I always say, you know, you can have your builder, you can have your architect reach out to me. I've talked to plenty of them. I've talked to the code folks as well. And it's been an interesting process of just kind of educating people about what it means to that. And then it also seems I'm not a therapist, but just being able to listen because people have, you know, they have to process their loss and understand that that if they want to rebuild, they've got to do things in a certain way, but they also want to vent, I think.
Yeah. Well, what an important point. And I think another reason that I'm so grateful that you were in a position to be able to be serving on this role, because I know that you are the kind of person that would be able to have that, you know, to listen and provide that empathy throughout a really difficult time. So thank you for that you are quite comforting to a lot of people. So I want to just understand all of these rebates that you're talking about. You mentioned some of them were, you know, there was some tack on to some rebates through the state of Colorado that it sounds like are in existence for anybody, whether they're rebuilding from the Marshall Fire or not, or is this also, is everything that you're describing only available and directly related to Marshall Fire, and are they through the utility company and then potentially the state?
Yeah, so they are only available for the Marshall Fire.
Okay.
And if your home was completely destroyed, so a lot of people have smoke and damage, smoke and ash damage in their houses. These particular rebates are not available to them even.
Okay.
So if the house is burnt to the ground and you're rebuilding from scratch, the programmatic rebates are all come through Xcel Energy. And then the state of Colorado has this $10,000 electrification rebate as well.
Okay.
The state of Colorado is beginning a process of creating a rebate programs for some of the other fires that happened in Colorado before the Marshall Fire.
Okay.
And I'm helping with one of those in the East Troublesome Fire in Grand County up near Winter Park, Colorado. It's understanding the impact of fires from Marshall Fire, realizing that they probably didn't do enough for these other fires, and trying to figure out how to help in any way that they can now in the process.
Wow. Well, so kind of a retroactive look back to people who are presumed that they're through all of the, you know, the process of rebuilding, dealing with insurance, you know, they have a new home and they're moving on with life. And then they might actually find out that there's an opportunity for them to recoup some rebate.
Yeah. So I'm going to grossly exaggerate, but roughly half the people have rebuilt or decided they're not going to, and half the people haven't started yet up in Grand County. So yes, for those folks that have already rebuilt, trying to figure out what they did and benchmark what they did and how is it in alignment with like the 2021 code, and is there a way that we can retroactively qualify them for a rebate or some money to help that kind of offset some of those costs there.
Okay.
And then the other folks that are still in the process of rebuilding, can we get in and kind of guide them to building to the 2021 or to Energy Star levels there?
Okay.
And then there's electrification stuff as well. And then in the Marshall Fire, you know, they started this early enough so that in the Marshall Fire, people can make those choices, hopefully early in the construction process. And a lot of my conversations are about, you know, building your team, picking builders, asking questions. Have you ever built to a program before? Have you worked with an energy rater before or an energy consultant before? Do you understand kind of the integrative design process and kind of working your way through that? And even though we hit a lot of people early, a lot of people come to us and say, oh, we're permitting our house and we're going to do this. And it's like, well, have you done X, Y, and Z before you permitted your house to know that you're actually going to be able to achieve this incentive level? And unfortunately, you know, a lot of people have to take a step or two backwards before they can move forward to successfully achieve the rebates. And it's going to be interesting. I think there are a number of us that are worried that at the end of construction, they might not be able to actually certify the house and get the rebate because they didn't take full advantage of resources that are available to them, or they haven't, you know, followed all the requirements of these programs.
Yeah. And, you know, this conversation now that we're, you know, this part of the conversation is something that you and I are very familiar with, aside from a rebuilding from a fire and incentives related to that. So much about what is misunderstood and the miscues that I feel occur in, you know, building better homes and high performance homes is that understanding of starting as early as possible on, you know, creating a team of people who understand the mission, understand what the charter is of what we're trying to achieve, and baking that in from the very beginning. And so I'm hopeful that I'm hoping that you're going to answer this next question with what I want to hear. Do you think that this is making a difference in how local, presumably it sounds like mostly custom builders are thinking about how they can build better, how they can improve their business in the future? Do you find that builders, contractors, tradespeople are still, you know, just kind of doing things because they have to, because they see that it's necessary to help this particular homeowner get the these incentives and rebates, and they can't wait for the project to be over and go back to doing what they used to do? Or do you feel like lights are going off and they're seeing the value, they're energized, no pun intended, to, you know, bake this into their business moving forward? You know, what's the temperature like out there with the contractors that you're interacting with?
Yeah, that's a really interesting question. And it seems like it's all over the board. There are definitely some folks that have just kind of run with it and incorporated it, and it's just going to become part of their foundational way of how they work moving forward. There's others that are recommending to people that they build back to the 2021 IECC, I'm sorry, to the 2018 IECC, and they're just foregoing $7,500 and just not realizing that, you know, somebody told me yesterday, or, you know, this past weekend, I was at an event, and their builder is telling them that the incremental cost to go from the 2018 to the 2021 is $25,000. And I just can't see it. I don't see where that money is being allocated there. But even if it was there, I talk to people a lot about opportunity cost, and that you just lose this opportunity. Once the drywall is installed, you don't have an opportunity to change the characteristic, the fundamental way that house is going to be performing. And you're losing out on at least some money to incentivize you to do a little bit more there. So it's kind of all over the board. You know, the biggest thing is that I think it is opening up people's ideas of what's possible and just exposing them to some of these programs and codes. I also have heard, I don't know if it's true yet, that Xcel Energy might be offering or might be looking at how to offer rebates outside of the Marshall Fire rebuild, probably at a much reduced level. But for they already do an incentive program for builders to build to kind of a modified Energy Star level that's based off of a tiered energy rating index, but they might be moving towards taking the rebate levels that they currently have and taking it outside of the Marshall Fire at some reduced rate. But that's just rumor right now. But if that, that could be something that is great that comes out of this tragedy, and to get, I think, utilizing the programs that are out there to help affect change with a broader audience is an ideal way of doing it.
Yeah. Well, and it seems like the Inflation Reduction Act would be, you know, providing some additional incentive to builders to, know, take the lessons that they're learning through this process and, again, be able to apply that to other projects and other clients that are, you know, not affected by the Marshall Fire, but have the opportunity to take advantage of real world incentives right now that are available to anybody that's building or renovating a new home.
The 45L tax credits seem to be the most impactful in new construction. It's unclear to me anyway, how the Inflation Reduction Act is incentivizing installing a heat pump, for example, in new construction. It seems to be a pretty good pathway in to retrofit or remodeling a house, but I don't see a clear rebate pathway for new construction for some of those other technology things that are being incentivized through the Inflation Reduction Act. So it'll be interesting to see how that happens.
Yeah. And so many of us in this industry are just on pins and needles waiting for a lot of the IRA information to be clarified and finalized. It's, you know, we keep hearing that that's coming this spring and summer. And I, for one, am personally very anxious to get some clarity on that. So, what can you tell us, Robby? It sounds like a lot of these incentives are related to energy, which is wonderful. I mean, that's certainly something that you and I are passionate about. But what has come up in this process related to fire resistance and building for, you know, to prevent something like this happening again and being as much of a tragedy as it was?
Yeah. I've done some trainings on fire. Some people call it hardening your building shell or firewise construction. The Fortified program has a new wildfire prepared program. So there are a variety of different kind of programmatic ways to address it. But interestingly enough, it hasn't been directly incentivized until just recently through what's called DOLA in Colorado, which is interestingly, it's the Department of Labor in Colorado, but the state of Colorado is offering a loan and grant program to people rebuilding. And they've just added about, you potentially can add an additional about $30,000 into most of them are income qualified loans or grants that are potentially forgivable if you stay in the house 3 years, I believe.
Oh, wow.
But anyway, they're adding some money to harden your shell there. And there are other groups like the Colorado Green Building Guild and others and education that I've provided to the community that are trying to demonstrate that building energy efficiently also is building fire wise. There are cases out there where a gentleman who's a passive house builder retrofitted his own home his neighbors got severe smoke damage, his house tightness, and his ability to turn off his whole house control mechanical ventilation system as he was exiting the house and being evacuated, saved his house from getting any severe smoke damage.
Wow.
So building tight is one of the primary ways to harden your shell against fire.
Interesting.
Doing conditioned attic spaces, conditioned crawl spaces, so that embers are the biggest issue with the fire, and you don't want those embers to actually get sucked into your attic as the wind and fire pressure is creating a positive pressure on the windward fire side of the house. It's creating a negative pressure on the other side. The embers actually get sucked into your attic space and catch the house on fire from the inside out there. So having a unvented attic and unvented crawl space, all those things that help you from an efficiency perspective can also help you from a perspective of being firewise and firewise construction. And then, you know, we talk about materials, the cementitious siding. Interestingly enough, I'm a big proponent of ventilated siding and ventilated air gap behind your siding.
Sure.
But you have to be careful about that space and putting a screen there to prevent embers and other things from getting up behind the siding and whatnot. So it's been a learning curve, and it hasn't been emphasized enough probably. But the Marshall Fire was a pretty unique wildfire. It's, you know, it's in a very, very urban setting on the Front Range. When we think about wildfires, we think about it up in the mountains with all the pine trees burning and whatnot. Yeah. So it was a grassland fire, severe wind occurrence in conjunction with, you know, the spark that started the fire, which we still don't know exactly what started the fire. But that the wind was so great that it really spread it, and you can see how far the embers, the real issue of the fires, the embers were able to travel. They say embers can travel, you know, up to 5 miles or more, and it crossed Highway 36, which is a huge, you would think would be a huge fire break, but the wind was just able to take it over there. So, you know, some people are rebuilding in kind of a firewise way. And I think it's in the back of people's minds, but it definitely probably isn't talked about as much as it could be.
Yeah. Interesting. Well, I definitely learned something new today, which is that intersection of the things that we're doing to make the home tighter from an energy efficiency standpoint, that's beneficial to fire resistance, which is great to know. So let's wrap it up with, is there one, you know, particularly impactful story that you can share with the audience of, you know, whether it is a homeowner, or, you know, kind of tying back to what we said earlier, is there a builder or a tradesperson that you've seen, you know, a major light bulb go off? What is one thing that we can end with that's a really, you know, positive feel good story that's coming out of this that you've been able to, that you've shared an experience with?
Yeah. What comes to mind, to me is this group of homes. They're actually built like townhomes. So this is wildflower community, but the community doesn't own the land underneath it. Okay. So they're,
is it a land trust?
I don't know. I guess the homeowners association owns the land, and then the individuals own the units. So they're classified as, they're classified as condominiums, but they're actually, when you look at them, they would be pretty classically townhomes.
Okay.
You would think of. And the homeowners association had different ideas, or the leadership, I guess, had different ideas than some of the community members in terms of how they wanted to rebuild. And also the insurance industry's pressure and just the ability of people to advocate for themselves and for the community was just kind of overwhelming, that they put it on themselves. You know, a few of them put it on themselves to get involved, to say, in essence, no to the leadership of the association, that we want to rebuild better and in a different way. And we were able to work with them to, they actually ended up having to build under the commercial IECC codes.
Okay.
But we got them to rebuild under the 2021 code so that each of those units were eligible for some of the rebate dollars there. And then I think opened up their minds to some of the other features of Energy Star and whatnot, so that some of the individual, where they have options, they might be able to make better choices there. But it was really not so much what I did, but what they did for themselves, or, you know, some of them did for their community there. And that's, I think, happening, you know, across the Marshall Fire area.
Yeah. That's awesome. I never underestimate what, you know, one or two, or, you know, a small group of people, the impact and change that they can enact when they put their minds to it. That's great. Yeah. Well, as I said, I am so grateful that you were appointed this opportunity to support this. I couldn't imagine that there would be many people out there that would be better suited, both related to, you know, the technical background and expertise, and then, as we already talked about, your demeanor and ability to manage this kind of emotional roller coaster that a lot of people are going through. And so I'm grateful for you and grateful for everything that you bring to our industry as a whole. And are there any final thoughts that you have before we wrap up today? Anything about this or other work that you're excited to, you know, drop some hints about that you'd like our audience to know about? Maybe you know, anything in the code development world that's we might bring you back on and talk about in the future?
Well, two things came. The first thing was with your gratitude. I appreciate that. but I have to, you know, I think you know Patricia Rothwell with the Energy and Efficient Building Coalition here in Denver. Just pointing out the importance of your networks.
Yeah.
And sharing information, because I wouldn't have found out about this position if it wasn't for her passing it along, because I wasn't on the email chain that where the job opportunity came up. So share information with your network there.
Wonderful.
And that's
a great, you know, just offsite dirt. That's what we're all about, is just creating an opportunity for all of us to collaborate and bring awareness to all of the great things that are going on in our industry. And so that's a great point, that it's so important for us to be sharing and collaborating, learning what each other can bring to the table, so that when the right opportunity comes up, we can say, this is who you need to talk to. And I know just the right person for that. So
yeah.
That's great.
Yeah. And then the other thing that crossed my mind was with regards to codes, get involved with it. And I bristle about every time I hear people say that code is the way to build the least, excuse my language, the shittiest house that you're legally right. allowed to build.
Right.
The back of my neck hairs bristle.
sure.
So. Code is equally as Energy Star or Passive House is a pathway into building better, higher performing homes. And we can't minimize that. I don't think we should be minimizing that. So The big part is how it gets this model code gets adopted and executed in your specific jurisdiction. So you have an ability to affect that adoption in your local municipality. So get involved.
Yeah, get involved. Almost as important as voting.
Yeah,
exactly. Great. Thank you so much, Robby. I am thrilled to bring all of this awareness and background to our Offsite Dirt audience. And thank you, all of you, for joining today on Building Better with Karen. We'll see you next time.
Hey, thank you so much.